Hi, today we are going to take a look at this little thing. This little thing is a servo accelerometer. As you can see, it is a Russian accelerometer. It is written DLU-MM-30. We can see some traces of soot here. This thing was inside a radar seeker of a large missile which exploded. I have also the central mechanism of this radar seeker. You can see that there is another accelerometer. We can see here. There is also a rate gyro. The reference is DUSV42, I think. We will see this assembly in another episode. Okay, so there is here a little box. I think it is made with new metal. We can see that this thing is mounted in a bracket, and we can see we have two locating pins. So this permits to have a very accurate positioning, okay, on the frame. Okay, so we can see that the cover here is soldered to the base of that thing, so I think I will cut all around here. It will be the best solution, I think. I don't want to destroy something because of the heat. Okay, look at that. Okay, so we can see a kind of pendulous thing here. So we have a mass. Here, so the mass provides a torque. Okay, when there is an acceleration, a force actually, but a torque relative to the pivot point here. Okay, and we should have a feedback on the other side here using a coil probably. It is difficult to see. So you can see that we have two terminals here on the bottom. And we have also two signals here on the second coil. And we can see here a small piece of copper. I don't know exactly the function. It is maybe a damping. Let me see. Okay, I don't see anything electrical here, so I don't know. Okay, so we can see that the mass is more important on the right here because of this protuberant thing here. Okay, so effectively, we should have a different mass here, otherwise it cannot work. Okay, so the force is applied on that side, and we should have here a compensation force on the other side. Okay, so it can be interesting to do the reverse engineering of this little thing to understand how it works. Okay, so, and on the top side here, we have actually a servo amplifier. There is a stack of three PCBs here. This part should be an op-amp here. It will be a little bit complicated to separate the PCBs here because of these rigid wires. It is not complicated to remove the board on the top here, but there's the one I think I will cut the wires here. At least these three wires here. Okay, we can see the top board here. There are several passive parts, two SMD capacitors. Okay, and we can see that we have also other SMD capacitors on the solder side of that board. You can see that they are connected using tiny wires. Okay, so we can see all PCBs here. It is difficult to see, but there is actually an IC underneath the passive parts here. I don't know if you can see this IC, and here we can see two SMD capacitors. This part is probably an op-amp. Dead code 2013. I will disorder these passive parts here in order to see the IC underneath these parts. Okay, we can see this IC here. It is written 1NT 251. Dead code 2013. Okay, so next step will be to do the reverse engineering of that thing. This is a complete schematic of the servo accelerometer. The most important part is the sensor itself, which is here. Let's have a look first at this sensor. On the top here, we have two coils, which permit to generate the feedback torque. An acceleration provides a force to that mass here, which in turn provides a torque around this pivot here. A variation from the null position is detected using a zero detector. The zero detector is made using different coils. We can see here B10, B11, and B8, B9. This is a kind of variable transformer. There are two excitation coils, which are in series, B10 and B9. They are supplied using a Colpitts oscillator, which is here. The oscillation is provided using the inductance of the excitation coils here and these two capacitors. Here we have two copper plates, one here and one here. When the copper plate enters these coils here, there are some losses on the copper plate. Therefore, the voltage induced on the pickup coil here is lower. Two DC currents are created. One is positive using this diode and this resistor. This point is a virtual ground. And a negative current is created using this second diode here. When the system is balanced, this positive current compensates the negative current here. So therefore, the net current here is null. If there is an unbalance, there will be here a positive or a negative current. Okay, so this current is fed to an integrator. The output of the integrator is connected to this power stage. The output of the amplifier drives the feedback coils, which generate the feedback torque. The current returns to this resistor here, and the voltage across these resistors is actually the output of that system here. So this is an image of the feedback current here. We can see that we have here two other coils. These coils permit to generate another torque. These two coils are probably used for test purpose. If you apply a current through these two terminals here, a torque is provided. So this is equivalent to have an acceleration. The torque will be compensated by the system. So a current here generates actually a current in the feedback. Okay, so through the feedback coils here. So this permits to know if the system works or not. Okay, we can see here some details about the zero detector. You can see this copper plate here. We should have normally three coils here. In the middle, we should have the excitation coil. And we can see the two pickup windings, this one and this one. We have here the details of the complete sensor. So we can see the feedback coils here, this one and this one. So they are connected in series. For the test, I have connected this servo accelerometer to a power supply, plus and minus 12 volts. As we will see, this thing doesn't work. I am going to turn on the power supply. Okay, so we can see that this thing is not regulated. Okay, it is saturated on that position here. Okay, it should be something like that in the middle, stabilized here. But with the schematics, it is possible to figure out what is the problem. An important signal to measure is the voltage on that point. We should have zero when this thing is stabilized. And actually, the voltage is strongly negative here. The problem is that there is no voltage across the secondary winding of this detector here. On the other side, there is a voltage of 10 volts peak to peak approximately. When this thing is centered here, the frequency is 830 kHz. I think that the primary coil here is open. Actually, they are connected in parallel. Okay, so we can see on the oscilloscope here the AC voltage of one part of the zero detector. Okay, we can see that if I change the position, okay, you can see the attenuation of that signal. So this is due to copper losses. Okay, it is possible to do the same by inserting this small piece of copper here in between. Okay. So it is difficult to repair because the connections to the windings are on the bottom side of the sensor and it is soldered. There is a small PCB here and the wiring is underneath this PCB, so it is not accessible. Okay, so we need to desolder everything here. So I will do something else to be able to test something. I will disconnect the diode, okay, to this winding here, and I will apply a positive voltage here. The positive voltage should be adjusted in order to have zero mean current here. Okay, you can see I can adjust the zero position. This thing is very sensitive. Okay, so this is plus 1G, approximately 0.2 volts. Okay, and minus 1G. Minus 0.2 volt. Okay. The range is plus or minus 20 G's for this one. For a full scale of plus or minus 5 volts. That means 4 G's per volt. So 0.25 volts for 1 G. Okay, so we have here the full scale, plus or minus 20 G's.